Thanks to Brilliant.org for supporting PBS Digital Studios. Black holes are really only dangerous if you get too close. Who am I kidding? It turns out that they may be responsible for ending star formation across the entire universe. When we first realized that black holes could have masses of millions or even billions of times that of the Sun, it came as a bit of a shock. They were discovered as the driving force behind quasars, where matter is heated to extreme incandescence before it plunges into vast black holes. But if that weren't enough, we soon realized that every single decent-sized galaxy contains such a supermassive black hole. By the beginning of the 21st century, it became clear that black holes and the galaxies that contain them are very closely connected. The bigger the galaxy, the bigger the supermassive black hole. Now that might not sound surprising, but what was weird was how closely they were connected. There's a tight correlation between the mass of the central black hole and the mass of the stars in the galactic bulge. That's the central ball-like part of a spiral galaxy, or the entirety of an elliptical galaxy. And every bulge contains a supermassive black hole around 1/1000th of its mass. And there's an even tighter relationship between the black hole mass and the speed that stars are moving in their random orbits within the galactic bulge, the so-called stellar velocity dispersion, which itself depends on the total mass of the galaxy, including dark matter. So why shouldn't a galaxy and its black hole be closely connected? A couple of things you need to know. Even though supermassive black holes are big, they're peanuts compared to the galaxies they live in. Their gravitational influence should only extend to the stars right at the very center of the galaxy. They definitely aren't directly responsible for the speed of stellar orbits outside their local region. Sure, galaxies and their black holes probably grew together, but galaxy formation is an extremely messy process, so you'd expect a huge amount of variation in black hole versus galaxy mass. Because of all of this, the tightness of the black hole-galaxy connection has been a decades-long conundrum that still is not solved. But one of the leading ideas is that central black holes somehow extend their nefarious influence throughout the entire galaxy, disrupting its ability to grow. To understand this, we first need to understand how galaxies form. In short, small galaxies collapse from the gas of the Big Bang, then they smash together to make bigger galaxies. This is bottom-up hierarchical galaxy formation, as opposed to top-down, which would have the large galaxies collapsing directly from the gas early on. Now, based on our understanding of the physics of the universe, especially the nature of dark matter and dark energy, we expect bottom-up galaxy formation. This is what we see in our simulations of the universe, and also mostly agrees with what we see when we look out into the universe. So, galaxies first grew in clusters, in the densest parts of the universe, places where enormous wells of dark matter pulled in great rivers of material from all around. Gas poured into the clusters from the outside universe, igniting bouts of extreme star formation called starbursts. As galaxies grew, so did their black holes. They will have started as already massive seed black holes formed by the very first generation of stars. They would fall to the centers of their local wispy proto-galaxy, and when wisps merged, their central black holes would also merge, all the while gorging on the rich gas supply in the early universe. So, black holes grew as galaxies grew. Then, why is it so surprising that they appear so closely correlated in the modern universe? Two things. In order for the black hole to grow in lockstep with the galaxy, you need to get a consistent proportion of new material down into the center of the galaxy. That's challenging given how messy and varied the whole galaxy assembly process seems to be. Second, observations seem to indicate that early black holes actually grew faster than their surrounding galaxies. The galaxy black hole mass relationships seem to evolve through the history of the universe. Many supermassive black holes were in place early, leaving the surrounding galaxies to catch up, like a puppy growing into its giant feet. In fact, we've seen quasars shining out from less than a billion years after the Big Bang, with masses of 10 billion suns, easily as large as the largest in the modern universe. So if black holes and galaxies are not growing in lockstep with each other from the same material, and they can't directly influence each other with gravity, how do they know what size to be? How does a galaxy know to stop growing when it's 1,000 times larger than its central black hole? Perhaps the best contender is that black holes kill galaxies. And by kill, I mean make them dead, which I guess is the usual sense of the word kill. But in astronomy, a dead galaxy refers to its current star formation activity. In particular, the largest galaxies in the universe are giant ellipticals, and we say they are red and dead. Not because they contain lots of Old West-themed planets, that's not yet known. But rather, it's because they appear to have almost no active star formation, and haven't had any for a long time. The short-lived hot mass of stars that give spiral galaxies like the Milky Way their blue-white sheen have long since died out in giant ellipticals, leaving them tinged with the orange-red colours of longer-lived, cooler stars. But from what we can tell, those giant galaxies should have kept forming stars. Giant reservoirs of gas flowed into those clusters from the outside universe. In our simulations of the universe, cluster ellipticals end up much bigger and bluer due to billions more years of ongoing star formation. A likely culprit is the black hole. It killed star formation in those giant galaxies, fixing the maximum size they could grow. The process is called quenching. There are a couple of different ways it can happen via black hole, but all of them involve a quasar switching on and blasting the crap out of the galaxy's gas. Rewinding a bit to the whole galaxy formation thing, when galaxies collide, or even get stirred up a bit by eating a smaller galaxy, gas tends to get driven down to the center where it's gobbled up by the black hole. Well, some of it is. Close to the black hole, the gas forms a whirlpool-like accretion disk heated by the energy of its long fall. It gets so hot that around 10% of the mass of the infalling gas is converted to energy in the form of light. And yet more of the gas is blasted outwards by that same light in colossal winds that rip through the surrounding galaxy, or it's channeled into jets by powerful magnetic fields. A quasar's intense brightness and these powerful winds and jets can dump an enormous amount of energy into the gas throughout the surrounding galaxy. That can do two things. It can drive gas out of the galaxy and prevent new gas arriving, or it can heat the gas. Either case is bad for star formation. In the latter case, it's because hot gas can't form new stars. Gas has to cool down before the force of gravity can cause it to collapse into stars. Too hot, and it stays puffed up. As well as killing star formation, quasar activity limits the black hole's own growth. It grows while eating the new supply of gas, but then its energy output stops new gas falling into the galactic center. In the end, you have this balancing act, a feedback process. The more mass of the galaxy, the more stuff it can pull in to feed itself and the black hole. But the more mass of the black hole, the better it is at shutting down both star formation and its own feeding. The end result is that black hole mass and galaxy size are closely linked. And in the largest galaxies, our red dead ellipticals, star formation is entirely shut down. Whether or not black holes killed star formation, or at least were the main culprit, is not established. But we do know that star formation died, or is dying. Not just in the largest galaxies, but across the universe. After the first stars formed, around 150 million years after the Big Bang, the rate of star formation across the universe slowly rose. It became concentrated in the most dense regions of the universe where giant ellipticals assembled. The rising storm of star formation reached a crescendo around 8 to 10 billion years ago and remained intense for a few billion years. Following that, the work of star formation shifted towards the outer regions further from the giant clusters. For the past several billion years, the cosmic star formation rate has been dropping and continues to do so. This is mainly due to star formation shutting down in the densest parts of the universe, which, as I mentioned, is strange given they should still have plenty of gas. There are other explanations besides quasars and black holes for the shutdown. Star formation has to be a somewhat self-limiting process because intense starbursts lead to intense supernova activity, which can also heat or expel gas and limit further formation. For the largest galaxies, the shock experienced by gas falling in from the outside universe can be enough to stop stars forming. All of these probably play some role in killing star formation. They are accomplices to the crime, but many astronomers think supermassive black holes are the main suspect. Here's one final clue. Compare the cosmic history of black hole growth to that of star formation. They grow together and peak at the same time around 10 billion years ago, right before star formation begins to die. Now, some very massive black holes existed earlier than this, somewhat perplexingly, but this peak in black hole growth represents the peak of the quasar epoch, when the most outrageously luminous quasars shone from the most ridiculously massive galaxies, surely enough to shut down those galaxies' further growth. In the modern universe, giant dead galaxies harbor fossil quasars, supermassive black holes whose close connection to their surrounding galaxy is a clue, incriminating evidence that suggests a long and violent struggle, a feedback cycle of growth and quenching that neither quasar nor star-forming galaxy would survive. And perhaps for the best, for the comfort of life-bearing worlds, to leave raging starbursts and fiery quasars to an earlier epoch of space-time. Learning astrophysics is tough. Thankfully, there are online tools that can help, like Brilliant, a problem-solving website that teaches you to tackle difficult topics and think like a scientist by breaking up complexities into understandable pieces. And instead of just passively listening to lectures, you get to master concepts by solving interesting and challenging problems. So, whether you want to learn about special relativity, quantum physics, or brush up on your complex algebra and differential equations, you can learn more at brilliant.org/spacetime. Last time, we talked about all the cool elements that get made when neutron stars collide. Your comments were gold. A number of people wondered whether the Fermi paradox might be explained by the fact that neutron star collisions are rare, so that only lucky parts of the galaxies have high abundance of the products of those collisions. Actually, although these collisions are rare, they're common enough that most of the galaxy gets a decent amount of all the stable products of neutron star collisions. On the other hand, the presence of highly radioactive stuff with very short half-lives is a telltale sign of recent merger, but that stuff probably isn't essential to life. Speaking of half-lives, Anthony Schroeder picked up a silly mistake. I said that the half-life is the average decay time of a radioactive element. It's not. It's the amount of time for half of a given sample to decay. And that's not the same as the average. In fact, it's longer by around 44%, or 1 over the natural log of 2. Thanks, Anthony. I guess I need to retake nuclear physics. Tricky asks us why we don't see more strange matter from neutron star collisions. Now, this is a cool point. It may be that some neutron stars are actually strange stars whose nuclear material is composed of strange matter, which means up, down, and strange quarks. If such a star was disrupted, then we would expect to see blobs of strange matter in the debris. But the thing is, strange matter is probably only stable under extreme pressure. Release it from the embrace of the neutron star, and all the strange quarks probably decay into boring old up and down quarks, which will join together to become protons and neutrons, which means you're back to where you started from. Even if strange matter is stable as so-called strangelets, these are electrically neutral, so they don't have an electromagnetic signature. Either way, you wouldn't actually see strange matter, but you might see the result of its decay, a particular spectrum of radiation and cosmic rays, or in the detailed shape of the gravitational wave signal before collision. People are looking. Nadira Rahman notices that their cat loves the sound of my voice and moves closer to the screen every time. Actually, that's just because Mittens can sense my allergy and, like all cats, is drawn to my suffering.